Hi, and welcome to the Electronics and Programming Beginner's Guide. Today we're going to talk about relays. If you are a product of a classical electrical engineering bachelor's kind of degree, relays are not something that's discussed in the curriculum, and oftentimes you find yourself lacking that piece of information. For those of you that will get this, this goes to this goes to this. But anyway, what is a relay? A relay is an electromechanical device that allows the use of a small current to switch a very large current. One way to think about a relay is a relay as a precursor to like a bipolar junction transistor or a MOSFET. And only in the digital sense, because relays can't do any kind of amplification or anything. Relays only switch on or off. But relays are capable of doing digital logic, and there is a whole branch of industrial automation that use something called ladder logic, which came from the idea of using relays to do digital logic. Also, if you've ever seen inside a very old pinball machine, they also use relay type logic. Now, what I have pictured here is the very basic anatomy of the simplest relay. What you have is a coil. When you apply power to that coil, this coil creates a magnetic field. Over on the other side here, you have three contacts. You have a common contact, which connects to a movable spring-loaded arm. And then you have the normally open contact, and then you have the normally closed contact. These are the basic abbreviations for the pins. Relays do, depending on which industry you're in like automotive or industrial, etc., have certain pin numbers they like to stick to, but I think that using normally open, normally closed, and common is a lot more useful. And then depending on which industry you're in, you can figure out what the pin numbers are from there. But the idea is that this arm is spring-loaded, and the spring holds it to the normally closed contact. When you apply power to this coil and the magnetic field is created, what happens is this arm is drawn over this way, and it will move from the normally closed contact to the normally open contact. That's it. That's really the basic operation of a relay. The biggest problem, kind of the devil in the details, is the ratings of relays. That there's all kinds of ratings for relays that get very confusing and aren't always clear how to tease them out of a data sheet. The relay that you see here is a single pole double throw, meaning that you have a single movable contact and it's moving back and forth between two fixed contacts. Switches also will have a similar rating. But with a relay, you'll only ever have a double throw relay. There we go. But you can have a whole bunch of these ganged up together in a single relay. So you can have a double pole double throw, which would have two of these, and this kind of dashed line represents that the coil affects the arm, and you would just have a second one of these and a dashed line that moves over to there, etc., etc. Or you could have like a triple pole or quadruple pole double throw. Relays can actually get quite large in size as far as their poles go, and this is so you can switch multiple devices at the same time that aren't necessarily electrically related to each other. Now, when we talk about the ratings of relays, we're going to work our way here from left to right. And the left side of the relay The one with the coil is generally referred to as the control side, because this is what causes stuff to happen over here. It's the control. The stuff on the right here is generally referred to as the hot side of the relay, because both the voltage and current can be tremendously different from the control side to the hot side. You can have hundreds, if not thousands, of volts on the hot side being controlled with 12 or 24 volts on the control side. The control side of a relay can be both, can be either AC, DC, or both. The AC version of it is probably the simplest, is that you apply AC across the coil, and the coil provides the magnetic field, and the arm moves. On the if the relay is DC, it becomes slightly more complicated, because oftentimes you will be given a polarity, let's say plus minus. And with a DC relay, you always need a diode. The diode is in reverse bias across the terminals like this. And the reason being is that when you turn this coil off, the coil generates a large voltage spike coming back into the whatever is applying power to the coil. And particularly if it's digital electronics like a microcontroller, that kind of thing, you can fairly easily and quickly destroy those components due to the large voltage spike. By putting in the diode, this diode effectively clamps and dissipates that large voltage spike. If the relay does not have a diode built in, some DC only relays will have the diode built in. You need to be sure to install this diode externally, because like I said, you will destroy things on a DC relay without this diode. The reason an AC relay doesn't need this diode is because AC relays are, whatever you're driving the AC relay with is going to be tolerant of a spike that happens, plus the way the field inside the coil works its way back and forth due to the AC sine wave, and said everything is happy and healthy. Now, regardless of whether the control side of the relay is AC or DC, you will generally be given a voltage or a voltage range that the coil can tolerate, either AC or DC, and you will be given a current. And these are things to watch out for, to make sure that whatever device you're using, like a microcontroller for instance, can tolerate the kind of current that is generated by the coil. Now, working our way from left to right, going from the control side to the hot side, you have something in between. And you might ask, well, what's in between? Because there's nothing. You have the hot side, the control side, nothing in between. But the stuff that's in between is actually very important, and that's isolation. This is one of the biggest advantages to a relay when you compare it to like a MOSFET or BJT. And that is, a relay is fully isolated, meaning electrically there's no connection between the hot side and the control side. And often a data sheet will actually give you what the isolation rating is, and it's, they usually give it in KVs, thousands of volts. So, if a relay has like a 7 KV isolation, it means that if there is a potential difference of up to 7 KV between the control side, I'm sorry, between the hot side and the control side, you won't get an arc over it. This is particularly important for safety. Like if you're using something, you're using a little Arduino 9-volt battery powered microcontroller to control something mains powered. This will give you the isolation that you need so that you won't inadvertently electrify the Arduino and either blow it up or hurt yourself, because you're going to be touching something that's live. Moving on to the hot side of a relay. The hot side of a relay probably has the greatest amount of ratings, and they are the most misunderstood. The first rating is a voltage rating. The voltage rating for the hot side refers to how much voltage the hot side can tolerate, let's say between the normally open and common terminal, without getting arc over. The rating sometimes is in AC, sometimes is in DC, and the thing to remember about AC, if that AC rating is going to be given in RMS, but the peak rating is actually higher than that. The voltage rating is probably not as confusing as the current ratings. The current rating is incredibly confusing. The reason being is that the rating can either be given in AC, DC, or both, and not all relays can do AC, not all relays can do DC at the same time. And there are max currents and a breaking current. The profile of how the relay deals with the current changes depending on whether it's designed for AC, DC, or both. With AC current, it's easier to deal with because whenever this contact switches, so for instance, if you have something that's normally on using normally closed contact and you have current that's flowing through the relay, as the contact begins to move, when it separates the contacts right here, an arc will form. And this is pretty much unpreventable. Relays are specifically designed so the contacts here can tolerate a little bit of arcing. But with AC, that arc will quench or dissipate quickly, because with AC current, the current will go to zero 120 times a second. So in the time that the relay contact starts to move and an arc forms, the arc will quench. If you're using DC and you have the current flowing, when this contact starts to move, the DC current will continue to flow up until the gap between the arm and the fixed contact here becomes large enough that the current can no longer sustain the arc and the arc will go out. But this time is substantially, probably by an order of magnitude, larger than what happens with AC. Because of this arcing effect, whenever the relay contact switches, what you get is a different current for AC. It's usually substantially larger than for DC. Also, the relay will may have a rating for its max current, and that's really a reflection of what the wiring and movable parts in here can handle. Versus a breaking current, which is generally lower, because the breaking current refers to that arcing effect that we were just talking about earlier, and that breaking a large current can create that arcing, and the arcing is very bad, per se, because it can damage the contact. To further complicate things, some relays will have a rating for a resistive load, and some relays will have a rating for an inductive load. The reason that complicates things is the relays that do a resistive load, they'll give you a current rating, but then for the inductive load, the rating will be much lower. The reason for that is, again, current. A resistive load is the simplest load to turn on and off because a resistive load doesn't have any kind of inrush or inductive effects. For an inductive load like a motor, for example, let's say your contact is normally closed and your motor is on and you turn the relay on to shut off the motor, well, when the arm begins to move, the inductive properties of the motor want to keep the current flowing. So you're back to that effect of, as the arm starts to move away, you draw an arc, and that arc will last longer than that of a resistive load. And again, that kind of effect is generally bad. Another thing to watch out for are capacitive effects as well, because, for example, like computer power supplies are heavily capacitive. And so let's say you have a computer that's off, you know, is connected to the normally open contact, and as you start to move the arm over, when the arm gets close enough to the contact for arc over to happen, you'll get very large arc, because the capacitors in the power supply will start to charge and you get a big inrush of current. So even if the supply is, let's say, rated at 1 amp continuous consumption, you can have 50 to 100 amps of instantaneous inrush when the relay closes. Depending on the current rating of the hot side, relays come in different sizes. A reed relay can handle usually milliamps and is very, very small. And the draw of, you know, having a relay that's that tiny is that relays generally have a very, very low contact resistance. And that means that you can perform certain measurements across the contacts of a relay without skewing the measurement too much, or even being able to calibrate out the resistance of the contact. So what you find are reed relays, particularly in oscilloscopes. Whenever you change ranges and you start to hear clicking inside an oscilloscope, those are generally either reed relays or just very, very small relays that they're switching to different ranges inside the analog front end. As relays get a little bit larger, and you're talking, you know, in the range of, you know, 1 amp to 10 amps, something like that, you're in the normal relay range. That's really generally where relays tend to be referred to as relays. When you get to the really big relays, they generally refer to them as contactors. And we're talking, you know, up to thousands of volts and hundreds, if not thousands, of amps. Those relays, you know, can be quite large, and they're specifically designed to break large currents. Their contacts have special designs so that to minimize arcing, that kind of thing. Something to note with contactors. This is kind of a special case scenario, but it's something that you should be aware of. Contactors will sometimes have two coils instead of just one coil on the control side. The reason for this is that when you're switching the relay, it is far easier to hold the arm once the arm has switched than to actually pull the arm over. And the relay will have two coils to accomplish this, and it's to save power, so the control circuitry doesn't have to be quite as beefy. But the idea is that you have two separate coils. One is the pull-in coil, the other one is the hold coil. So when the pull-in and hold coils are energized at the same time, which causes the arm to come over, but when the arm comes all the way over, the pull-in coil gets turned off. This can be done in a very broad multitude of different ways. Sometimes this is entirely transparent to you as the user of the relay, because you will have, or I guess of the contactor, because you'll just have two wires on the outside, and some mechanical fashion on the inside will take care of turning the pull-in coil off. And what you'll see as far as current ratings are like before the relay is turned on, because you'll have a much higher current rating, and then after the relay is turned on, you'll have a lower current rating, because as the relay is turning on, you're using both coils, and once the relay is on, you're just down to the hold coil. Other times you'll see the coils brought out of the relay separately, and then you have to take care of controlling them both and making sure that you get that switch where you shut off the pulling coil just to use the holding coil taken care of. Now, something else that's fairly confusing about relays that I wanted to cover are relay symbols, what you actually see on a schematic. This here is a fairly common representation for the automotive industry, and you will generally find this in a box that's listed on a single page where it'll show you what your control side is, and sometimes these will go off to, you know, let's say this will ground here, and this will go to an off-page reference, meaning to some other page on the schematic, and then you have the control side, sorry, the hot side, and on the hot side, things will go off to other things. But the thing to know is you will generally find this whole thing on a single page, and this is fairly easy to wrap your mind around. This is the industrial representation of a relay schematic symbol. And usually this is the biggest stumbling block for electrical engineers when they're first starting off in industry. And because while I told you that these are relay symbols, these look a lot like capacitors. This is the biggest, you know, the biggest stumbling block. You know, why do you have all these capacitors everywhere? You don't. These are actually relay symbols. And this symbol here represent exactly what I had drawn before, that these are the normally open contacts, and this line here represents the normally closed contact, and then you have your, you know, normally open, normally closed, and then this is the common. And this is the control side of the relay. What makes the whole thing far, 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 far more confusing is that there's absolutely no guarantee that this part of the symbol, and sometimes you'll only see just the normally open contacts or just the normally closed contacts, and the control side are ever on the same page. And what you'll find is that relays tend to have a symbol name of K. So you'll see something like K12. And then somewhere on some other sheet here, you'll see another K12 and another K12. And what you have to put together in your noggin is that this K12 control side switches the K12 hot side someplace else. Now, before we tear into a relay, I have a couple of relays that we're going to take a look at. We're going to pop them open and take a look at the innards. There are some other things that we need to talk about. The first one is, how do you hook up a relay? It may sound intuitive, but not always, so I just wanted to mention. For instance, if you have a device that's normally off and you want to turn it on with the relay, you would use the normally open contacts here. So you can either attach power to the normally open contact and then your device to the common contact, which tends to be the preferred way to do this. And so when the coil turns on, the arm will move from the normally closed contact to the normally open contact, and power will begin to, you know, flow in this direction toward your load. The reason why this tends to be normally preferred is that if you think about it, and if you apply power to here, particularly if it's like mains or something dangerous, when the relay is off, this contact here is open and energized, and that's generally considered bad. Not always, because oftentimes these relays are sitting in sockets that they're specially designed to plug into, and those sockets are sitting in a case that's metal and grounded and shielded, etc. And it's not an issue if you want to have the power applied here and, sorry, the power applied to the common contact and come out here. Other things you can do is, let's say, switch between two things. So if you have a signal that comes in the common side, you can switch it between the normally closed contacts and the normally open contacts by energizing and de-energizing the relay. Now, there are three other relay types that I wanted to at least mention for clarity. The first being a latching relay. Latching relays used to be very, very popular, particularly in the days of relay logic, or ladder logic. The idea of a latching relay is a latching relay works a lot like the light switch in your house, where you only have to apply some sort of force to it for a short period of time. You flick the switch, and once the switch is flicked, the switch will stay in that position. And so a latching relay will have two separate coils. You have the set coil and the reset coil. What the set coil does is it moves the contact from the normally closed position to the normally open position. And once that move happens, the relay will stay there in the normally open position. And then when you want to switch the relay back in the other direction, you apply power to the reset coil. And again, you only need a momentary apply for the set to switch the relay in one direction, and then a momentary apply to the reset coil to switch the relay in the other direction. Something else to note with both latching relays and all kinds of relays is that you will get in a data sheet a timing for how long, the minimum amount of time you have to turn on the set or reset coil to make it switch. And it's not instant. You don't just apply it for a millisecond or two and the relay's on. It usually takes longer than that, but again, refer to your data sheet. Another kind of relay variant is a force-guided relay. This relay is probably the most confusing to understand. And a force-guided relay will always have two or more poles. That's what makes it a force-guided relay. And the idea behind the force-guided relay is the multiple poles are mechanically attached to each other in such a way that if one was not to switch properly, the rest of them will also not switch, and you never get this instance of where you can have one pole that's, let's say, stuck and the rest of them will switch off. This may seem trivial, but this usually is used in safety type circuits. The final relay variant I wanted to talk about is a safety relay. Safety relays are special because they're used for safety. What does that mean? That means that the spring inside of a safety relay is specifically designed to be large enough that if something were to happen to the contacts, for example, if the contacts were to weld themselves closed, the spring is large enough to be able to rip them apart. Because it's called a safety relay, it's kind of obvious. It's generally used on safety circuits, particularly like e-stops or of the such. But these relays tend to be very, very large because the coil to be able to large enough to be able to move that size of a spring tends to be very large, and these relays are very bulky and unwieldy. Failure modes of a relay. Generally, relays do not have any kind of problems on the control side. You can theoretically have a coil go open or short, but very, very, very rare. All the problems always happen on the hot side. And the two most common failure modes with relays are either high resistance in the contacts or the contacts weld themselves. What does that mean? Whenever the relay is switching back and forth, let's say you have all the ratings for the relay correct, but the relay will have some sort of a life rating on it. And that is, as the contacts move back and forth, open and close, thousands, if not millions of times, the contact surfaces will eventually become worn, and they will either make bad contact, or they're pitted or whatnot. And so when the relay switches over, instead of having that really nice low contact resistance that, you know, relays are famous for, you get a higher resistance and higher resistance, and eventually it may even get to the point of when the relay switches, it still shows open. The other failure mode is welding. And actually, I guess let me clarify. Another thing is you can get high resistance in relay contacts if you're switching loads that the relay isn't meant for, and the arcing is burning the contacts up. Now, the second failure mode, welding, generally happens, again, when you're driving something that the relay isn't meant to drive. You have very high inrush currents, or you're driving very inductive loads, and you draw arcs as you're turning the load on and off, and the contacts can become welded, meaning that the arc is so intense that the surfaces of the contacts become so hot they actually become molten, and once the relay finally touches, they weld together. And so now, whereas if the arm moved back and forth, the arm can come over and boom, it's stuck. And so what the relay is controlling either won't turn on or won't turn off. So now let's jump over and actually take a look at the some innards of relays. What we see here are two fairly typical relays. This is an automotive relay, something you typically would find in a car. This one specifically came out of, if I remember correctly, it was an alarm system. It was an accessory relay that just didn't get used. And this relay here is more of an industrial relay. This is actually a board mount relay. You would solder this into the board, and I've cracked it open to show you what's inside. This relay was actually sealed quite heavily. I had to really cut at it. And so now let's take a look inside. This relay here, as I mentioned, is a board mount relay. It's made by Hasco. This is a double pole, double throw relay. And if we go ahead and we lift the skirt on it, what we see is in the middle is the coil, and it dominates pretty much the entire relay. The pins for the coil are this one here and this one here, and you can't really see it well, but there is a wire that's attached to those pins that then wraps around here in the coil. The common of this, both the commons in this relay are over on this end, and if you follow it, these two pins come up this way, up the, let's call it the back, and then over to the top, and on top they come over to these contacts. And if we look at it from the side, this is the part that moves like that whenever the relay, the coil energizes and pulls down with the magnetic field. It makes it move up and down like that. And if we look over on this side, we can actually try and see the contacts. You can see a move back and forth like that. That this leg on the side that comes up and folds over here is the normally closed, and the one that moves down this way directly underneath is the normally open. And when the relay kicks over, when the relay turns on, it moves the contacts from the top to the bottom, just like that. And it's really that simple. There's not a whole lot to what's inside a relay. Now, this is the automotive relay. Because it's automotive, it's in the car, it's using a 12-volt system. And remember that diode I mentioned? In this relay, the diode is right here, and it's built directly into the plug for the relay. If we look at the top of the relay here, it will show you what the pinout of the relay looks like. This is a single pole double throw, just like we showed. And if you look closely, there are pin numbers.
85, 86, 87, 87A, and 30. And for automotive relays, these pins tend to stay pretty consistent. And if you flip the relay over and look on the bottom, you can actually see those pin numbers directly in the relay. In the case of this relay socket, you'll notice that one of the pins is not populated. There's only four here. And that's because these kind of relays are normally used to just turn things on and off. So the one that's not populated is actually 87A. So when the relay is not energized, nothing is happening. And then when the relay becomes energized, the arm kicks over and connects 87 to 30. Now I've gone ahead and popped this relay open. These relays are not sealed, so you can usually just by prying around the edges here, get them to pop out. Sometimes it's annoying. This one was really annoying. And for automotive relays, that's actually really nice because you can do some diagnostics with automotive relays in the sense of that you can, you know, pull the relay out of the socket, pop the top off of it, pop the relay back in, and with your hand, you can actually push on the arm and energize the relay to see if stuff is working. You know, fuel pump relays, that kind of thing, whether, you know, is it a problem with this computer circuit or something else. But automotive relays tend to be, you know, as compared to one of these little guys, support a little more current, so all of the contacts in it are more beefy. Also, kind of the general superstructure is more beefy because cars are very, very high vibration environments, and if you don't really beef up the superstructure of the relay can fail internally from cracking, etc. Now let's take a closer look at the relay here. This braided wire here is the common, and the common comes over this way and attaches to this pin here, which is labeled 30. And the common attaches to the arm, and you can see the contacts here. Let me get a better look like that. That's the contacts moving. Then you see the coil here. This coil isn't covered up like that other coil was, and you can see the wires. One comes off right there, comes down to this pin, and heads down here, which is pin 58. The other one kind of sneaks off under there. The pin for it is right here, and then it heads down and attaches itself. You can see the wire attaching itself right there. Then your normally closed contact is this one right here, and this one kind of sneaks its way back there, and you can see it right there on the inside because that's this guy here. And your normally open contact is this guy here, 87. Right, do I have my, I'm sorry, normally open contact is 87, which is that guy there, and that contact comes down this way, comes around here, and goes right there. So hopefully that was a reasonably decent primer on relays. So whenever you start your new job and you see something that looks like a capacitor on your schematic, you won't be confused. You'll know that that is a relay right away. Usually relays are K. And so if you see a K next to a symbol that looks like a capacitor, that is actually the contacts of a relay. If you enjoyed my video, please give me a thumbs up. And thank you for watching.